Welcome to Atlanta for tonight's NCAA Southeast Regional Semifinal, where one team will earn a trip to the Final Four. Tech has carried the pressure of number one since last fall. In only his fifth year as Tech head coach, Bobby Kremen's Yellow Jackets have shown the strain. Much of the pressure has been carried by guard Mark Price, the Oklahoma native, whose outside shooting, court sense, and leadership are vital if Georgia Tech is to advance. For Georgia Tech, the question is, are we as good as the experts think we are? Dale Brown's LSU Tigers fooled all of the experts by overcoming tremendous adversity and surviving in great part because of John Williams, the sophomore power forward from Los Angeles, whose dominating physical skills led the surprising Tigers to two straight tournament victories last week on their home court in Baton Rouge.
Redden's going to take the shot.
One second.
The question for LSU, can they win away from home tonight in the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia? Ticket here at the Omni in Atlanta to watch the Southeast Regional Semifinal between upset-minded LSU, 11th seeded in the regional, against Georgia Tech, seeded number two. And good evening, everyone. I'm Dick Stockton, and everyone knows about home court advantage as far as LSU. They won two games on their floor in Baton Rouge last week. But now the shoe is on the other foot, and now they must play Georgia Tech in Atlanta, not on their campus coliseum, but here in the Omni. Now, during the year, Georgia Tech was 4-2, but when you look at their career record here in the Omni, it is not that impressive. Georgia Tech has won 12 and lost 11. I want to bring in my partner, Larry Conley, and so the question before the house would be, does Georgia Tech have a home court advantage or not?
Well, in my opinion, I don't think so. Because of the distribution in tickets, there are four teams here with almost an equal number of people inside the Omni. Georgia Tech's looking at a lot of good fans here, but I'm going to tell you, there are a lot of people here from Louisiana, too.
And, of course, a lot of Southeast Conference fans that have a big factor in this, too, right?
Absolutely. There are a number of Southeastern Conference fans here.
Last time these teams played was the last year that Georgia Tech was in the Southeast Conference, 22 years ago. Let's talk about LSU. They've had all kinds of problems, ineligibility, injury, and dismissals of players, yet they were started out 14-0. What is the reason why they avoided problems and stayed afloat with those problems?
Look, I think one of their biggest losses was Nikita Wilson. He's the guy that went out academically in January, and it forced Dale Brown to really get into some defensive changes. He basically goes with four different defenses, which Georgia Tech is going to have to take a look at tonight. And the guy that's going to have to shoulder that load for Tech is going to be Mark Price.
And you're going to have to decipher some of them, too, right?
And I'll do it.
All right. We know the signals, and Larry Conley will tell you what they're all about. Coming up, Georgia Tech and LSU here in the Southeast Region Semifinal.
Tonight's Southeast Regional Semifinal game is sponsored by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start. State Farm Insurance. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And by Quaker State. The big Q stands for quality. Always has. Always will.
You finally get the answer, and now you can't wait to tell someone. Here at Hewlett-Packard, we never stop thinking about how our business computing equipment can be used to solve your company's problems. It's the Hewlett-Packard way of doing things. We're always asking, what if?
I've got it. They need easy access to their database, right? What if we use the personal productivity...
Your automatic teller. Can I help you with a student loan?
No, a car loan, Leona.
Fast forward.
Home improvement loan.
It's a General Motors car.
Don't get hassled when you finance a new car or truck. Get GMAC financing only at your GM dealer.
Is there someone live I could talk with around
here? Do we have one of our calendars? This is a farm calendar. We also have what they call a credit calendar. If I can only find it, only.
Every day, more Americans work with Chevys than any other truck.
Up early, USA, there's a
lot of work you gotta do every day.
And when push comes to shove, nothing works like a Chevy truck.
Now get low 9.9 financing on new 10 and 20 series 2 and 4 wheel drive Chevy pickups.
Nothing works like a Chevy.
Oh yeah.
Chevy truck.
The main color is gold here. LSU with the purple and gold and Georgia Tech with the black and gold. There's the Tiger mascot. And this crowd, capacity crowd, has been a tremendously tough ticket here to watch Georgia Tech to see whether they can advance. They reached the regional final last year, only to lose to Georgetown in a heartbreaker.
It was a great basketball. If you look at the LSU record summary right here.
And their one victory against Final 16 teams was against Auburn, the team that advanced in the West Regional tonight. 13-8 on the road, and Dale Brown has always had good road records. As we pointed out, Georgia Tech is 4-2 this year at the Omni, an interconference loss to Illinois amongst them.
Well, in fact, Dick, I tell you what, they've had a great season. The only losses they've had, five of the six, have been to number one teams.
All right, we're ready for the starting lineups and for the introductions. Let's go to our public address announcer, Marshall Mann.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Metro Conference welcomes you to the Omni for this 1986 NCAA Southeast Regional game between the Louisiana State University Fighting Tigers and the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets. Now let's meet the starting lineup for LSU. At forward, a 6'8 sophomore from Los Angeles, California, number 24, John Williams. For Georgia Tech, at forward, a 6'8 freshman from Crestview, Florida, number 20, Tom Hammond. For LSU, at forward, a 6'6 senior from Monroe, Louisiana, number 44, Don Redden. Forward, a 6'6 sophomore from Tulsa, Maryland, number 33, Dwayne Farrell. For LSU at center, a 6'7 sophomore from Miami, Florida, number 33, Ricky Blint. For Georgia Tech at center, a 7-foot senior from Brooklyn, New York, number 22, For LSU at guard, a 6-foot senior from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, number 10, Derek Taylor. For Georgia Tech at guard, a 6'4 junior from Manhattan, New York, number 44, Bruce Dalrymple. For LSU at guard, a 6'5 junior from Plain Dealing, Louisiana, number 11, Anthony Wilson. For Georgia Tech at guard, a 6-foot senior from Enid, Oklahoma, number 25, Mark Wright. And now introducing the head coaches for LSU in his 14th season, Dale Brown. For Georgia Tech in his 5th season, Bobby Cremins.
Bobby Cremins will try to avoid LSU's upset bid. They've knocked off Purdue and Memphis State. Can they do it again? Back to the opening kick in just a moment.
Today's Equitable has new life insurance ideas that can provide money for a secure and comfortable retirement. Today's Equitable, your key to financial opportunity. We have new kinds of insurance that do more than just protect your family. They can help you earn the money for your new home. Today's Equitable, your key to financial opportunity. Our new insurance ideas can do a lot for you. Talk to us.
Equitable.
Your key to financial opportunity.
Okay, I've been doing a whole lot of talking about a beer that's different. Made by a brewer who believes they make better beer. But what's it all mean to you, huh?
Hey, buddy.
Hey. Me? I could taste the difference right off. Coors goes down smooth, easy. Even feels less heavy. The next thing you'll notice is none of the harsh aftertaste. No bitterness. Just the great taste of Coors minus any of the backlash. I don't know about you, but for me, that's the difference worth taking.
Larry, the key in any Georgia Tech game is to get the ball to the seven-footer John Salley in the middle, but Ricky Blandon, who's only 6'6", did a tremendous job in the zone defense for LSU against William Bedford of Memphis State. If he can do it again, LSU's got a good shot.
Well, I think the things you look at, when you look at Memphis State and Georgia Tech, they're so comparable. Both clubs have a lot of similarities, and I think that's going to be an advantage for LSU going up against a team that looks like the same club they played last week.
Finally, it's controlled by Salley of Georgia Tech there in the gold uniforms, LSU in purple, and we're underway. LSU playing the zone defense.
They're chasing. They've got a box, and they're chasing Wilson right now on Price.
Wayne Farrell out to Dalrymple. Good inside player. Dalrymple and a fine pass to Salley. A decisive opening for Georgia Tech here.
Dick, in some instances, when you've got that box and chaser, you use the guy being chased as a decoy. He'll pull that offensive way.
Derek Taylor misses. The ball comes out to Anthony Wilson, who is the hero of the game against Memphis State. John Williams, the big star for LSU, can't convert. And Hammonds gets the rebound for Tech. Push it up to Dalrymple. Dalrymple baseline. He got inside, and Mark Price will pick it up outside for Georgia Tech and slow it up.
Dick, did you see him slap the ball away? He was one on three and still was able to keep the ball alive.
Salley, the seven-footer, plays away. Farrell, straight pass to Salley. The basket counts and a foul. So the big guy getting the ball early has made things count for Tech.
Oh, what a start for the Yellow Jackets. How about that great passing by Georgia Tech? And they're getting it to the right guy, John Salley. Farrell, good dish in there. Look at Salley. Two in a row. That was his second one. Watch the first one. Dalrymple down the middle. Good dish. He finds him on the right side. And Salley, that was the first one. They shoot like that all night. They're going to be okay.
John Salley had a very jittery first half against Villanova. He settled down in the second half. He has been red hot toward the end of the year and has led Georgia Tech in rebounding. Tech got the board. Loose ball. And they save it into the hands of Anthony Wilson of LSU. 4-0, Georgia Tech leading. Don Redden puts it up, a good outside shooter. Gets his own rebound, and LSU is on the board.
But good effort by Redden there. Good fundamental principles right there. Shoot your shot and follow it. And Redden did, and he got a basket.
It's been the chemistry that Bobby Kremen says he's been missing so far. Hopefully, Tech will pick it up in a hurry as Dalrymple misses. And here's Derek Taylor, the point guard who led LSU in assist this season. John Williams, all everything for the Tigers. Anthony Wilson, who scored the winning basket. Averaging nearly 10 a game, and it's 4-4.
Dick, it wasn't quite as impressive. LSU's two baskets as Georgia Tech, but we are tied 4-0.
Dalrymple controlling outside. They want to look for him to pass the ball. He has not been an effective shooter as of late, but a tough rebounder, maybe the best rebounding guard in the country.
LSU continues with that box and chaser or diamond and one. It's Anthony Wilson, the job on Mark Price.
Hammond misses. Rebound by John Williams. Tremendous shoulders on the 6'8 sophomore from Crenshaw High in Los Angeles. Redden pulls up with the jump shot and hits. And LSU has run off 6 in a row to take the lead by 2.
How about that shot over Salley at 7 feet?
Redden's the best outside shooting player on the Tigers. Dalrymple. Loose ball. Derek Taylor. And the Tigers have now run off 8 in a row after Salley's decisive salvo to start the game with 2 stops.
Dick, right away, Mark Price is going to have to start the score. He's going to have to establish himself in this basketball game. And I don't know if Anthony Wilson's going to let him get that ball too easily.
That could be a key because Mark Price has taken nearly twice as many shots as any other player on the Georgia Tech team this year.
It puts a lot of pressure on those other players when Price is not taking shots.
Dishes it off, gets the pass into Salley, does Dalrymple, and Salley has all of Georgia Tech's points. It's 8-6.
Good start. Both teams, real active.
Tremendous pace by the upset-minded Tigers of LSU. 24-11 on the year. Georgia Tech matching the most wins in their history set last year, 27.
Georgia Tech is just playing a very conventional man-to-man defense, straight up fighting through the screens.
John Williams can hurt you from outside, but more important, they need him inside.
Interesting that Hammonds, the freshman, is guarding Williams.
You're all yours.
Redden gets the roll for him, went baseline and went up. Don Redden, the senior from Monroe, Louisiana, averaging over 12 a game, and LSU is up again by four. Both teams going to their bench early for some big people. Going in is Dalrymple, and Dalrymple, strong inside, gets the basket.
At that time, they were in a straight 2-3 zone. Dalrymple recognized it, went right down the gut of it, and laid it in.
Good shooting on both sides. Anthony Wilson gets the ball quickly, fires up, and Hammond gets the rebound. He is the fourth straight Georgia Tech player named Atlantic Coast Conference Rookie of the Year. Salley misses. Farrell tries to tip it up, and Blanton battles for the board. They got John Williams on the right wing.
One on three.
Pulls up. Price will start the break. Dalrymple will go all the way.
Dick, that was close. He almost missed it.
Nearly 5 minutes gone by in this tremendous pace game. LSU and Georgia Tech all tied at 10 all.
Was a fantastic pace the first 5 minutes.
Blanton and a good feed pass over Blanton. And they're going to call the foul against Georgia Tech. That was a good pass to Ricky Blanton coming into the ball game for LSU is Jose Vargas. There is Craig Neal, a 6'5 sophomore from Washington, Indiana, who plays in the backcourt for Georgia Tech. And for LSU, they bring in a 6'10 sophomore from the Dominican Republic, Jose Vargas, and we'll be back.
Now, almost every new car and truck that's made Chevrolet America's first choice is available with low 9.9 financing on new Corvettes and Camaros, Caprice and four-cylinder Celebrities, Cavaliers and Spectrums, plus S10 Blazers and pickups, Astro Cargo and full-size cargo vans, 10 and 20 series full-size pickups. 9.9 financing on almost every new car and truck that is made Chevrolet number one. 9.9 financing, now on today's Chevrolets.
Easy victory!
Too bad, Bob.
Party in my place.
Hey, I'll buy the food.
You? Where this way?
One of those 76 self-serve mods. They're bigger than ever.
Do they have hot dogs there, Mark?
Tacos?
Pizza? Chips and dips?
Everything, from gas to groceries.
Hey, pizza.
Soda.
Nachos.
Baby food, Junior?
No thanks.
No money.
No problem. Your 76 credit card.
The Spirit of 76.
An official sponsor of the Liberty Centennial.
The defending champion, Katarina Witt. The U.S. national champion, Debbie Thomas. The World Figure Skating Championships on CBS Sports Saturday and Sunday.
We're tied 10-10 in the first half. Problems that LSU experienced. The 7-foot Tito Horford dismissed. Dennis Brown and Zoran Jovanovic, a knee injury. He's a 7-footer, but the big man, Nikita Wilson, as Larry Connolly has said, they lost him on academic ineligibility. LSU yet started out 14-0, and they depended on Jose Vargas, the gentle giant, Dale Brown calls him, from the Dominican Republic, started 18 games, but not quite the intimidating player he should be for his size.
Dick, he's also a very emotional player. Dale Brown looks at that player for leadership on the inside, and Vargas has been able to deliver, but the one thing he's got, he is very, very emotional.
And he's got time to progress and grow. Redden is guarded by Dalrymple. And they're going to call a foul against Georgia Tech.
You know, Dick, I sit and watch Don Redden play a lot of basketball. He had 23 points against Memphis State the other day. And he really is a very active player on offense.
Foul is on Dalrymple, his first. Redden going up against him. This is the shot and the rebound is by Craig Neal. Craig Neal has provided some good punch in the backcourt coming off the bench. For Bobby Cremins, they don't go very deep in the bench in traveling call.
No doubt that now Georgia Tech had the opportunity right there, and Dalrymple couldn't convert it. LSU now coming back. Pace of the game has slowed somewhat.
Georgia Tech took a 4-0 lead, and then LSU scored 8 straight points. They're tied now with 14:24 to go in the first half. John Williams to Redden inside. Batted away by Salley, but into the hands of Derek Taylor. Blocks are good, but you might as well knock him into the hands of your teammates if you can.
Good move by Salley coming over and helping that time.
Here's Vargas. And Vargas misses inside. Price comes down with a loose ball, but that's what Dale Brown wants from him. Vargas.
Well, he's got to get inside, and he's got to go straight at Salley.
Price. Long
goes outside. Neal keeps it alive and gets the rebound. Price, the leading scorer, averaging over 17 a game, misses his first shot for Georgia Tech. Dalrymple looking into Hammond.
Hammond somewhat tentative to take that basketball and move on it. He kicked it right back out.
Impressive freshman gets a good feed in there, and a foul is called against John Williams of LSU.
Let's watch Salley on the other end. This was earlier. Redden really fighting on the inside of Dalrymple for that post position. Watch this strong move, but watch a better move here by Salley. Good rejection.
Wayne Farrell comes back in the ballgame for Georgia Tech, and Dalrymple goes out. North Carolina Louisville underway in Houston in the West Regional Semifinal.
Dick, that's a great ballgame. A lot of talent on those two clubs.
You could have seen those two in the Final Four, and nobody would have batted an eyelid. Here's Tom Hammonds from Crestview, Florida. Strong, muscular inside player. He and Salley each had 10 rebounds in the victory over Villanova. That's the first time they've done that this year.
Georgia Tech had a lot of success with ACC Rookies of the Year. You've got to credit Bobby Kremins with their recruiting.
Four in a row. Hammonds, poised, hit the free throws. 12-10, Georgia Tech lead.
Right now, 2-2-1 zone. Three-quarter court pressure by Georgia Tech. Give the LSU a little bit different look on defense.
Eric Taylor controlling the ball. Walks into a double team. Gets into trouble. Knocked away by Salley. Vargas saves it. Redden pops outside and hits again. As long as they have him doing that, LSU knows he'll stay in it. Redden with eight.
The thing about him makes him so good is he can do it on the inside and the outside. He's got a great jumper from 18 to 20 feet.
Salley playing on top, and Derek Taylor at 6 foot guarding him. Loose ball. Anthony Wilson has it. LSU, another turnover against Georgia Tech. Derek Taylor misses, and Price comes down with the rebound. Four rebounds already for Mark Price, the 6 foot guard. Farrell. Redden inside, comes down to Anthony Wilson. Here's Dale Brown tell it. These 9 of the 11 players on his squad are guards, including Don Redden and Ricky Blanton, who are playing forward and center, respectively.
Well, right now, Redden trying to take Farrell. He got Dalrymple earlier.
And Williams is on the line. Aaron pass. One of the few LSU turnovers, and Blanton comes back in the game. Vargas goes out.
Dick, I'm wondering if that pace, that very ferocious pace that these two clubs went at in the first 5 minutes, hasn't taken a little bit out of them, because the play has been very sloppy for about the last 3 minutes.
It has, and of course, Georgia Tech doesn't go too deep into their bench, maybe 6 and 7, that's all, and LSU kind of uses more players on their bench.
Well, you're looking at one of them right now, Craig Neal out top. He's the sixth man, and the other one's Antoine Ford, the big guy inside.
Price working his way in, draws the foul. It's on Anthony Wilson. It'll be Wilson's first personal foul. Wilson's a junior from Plain Dealing, Louisiana, near the Arkansas border. He had his career high of 25 points in the double overtime victory over Purdue in the first round.
Here's Price. Yeah, this young man right here has had an outstanding year for Georgia Tech, and really has brought them on the brink of having one of the great basketball programs in this country. And when they first started here, he was one of the first players that Bobby Kremins brought in as a winner, and he really has built them.
Mark Price has scored 20 points in each of the two tournament games so far for Georgia Tech. He has his first points of the game from the free throw line. 14-12, Georgia Tech leading. 12 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the first half.
Good matchup right there with Price against Taylor. Both of them exceptionally quick.
Williams knocks it inside. Neal had a hand on it. Redden loops it into John Williams. Into the hands of Hammonds. What were they trying? A one-handed play.
Did you hear Hammonds? He turned to Salley and said, John.
Knocked away. John Williams will take it himself. John Williams with his first basket of the ball game, averaging over 18. Top rebounder and scorer for the LSU Tigers. Ties it up for a fourth time.
Craig Neal slowing it down now, holding up one finger. LSU's now in a straight 2-3 zone. They continue to change those defenses.
And you'll notice Blanton does a good job inside, fronting Salley, who starts away. Redden fights inside, and the ball got caught between the glass and the rim. It got stuck.
Watch the steal right here. Derek Taylor going up against Mark Price. Watch the steal. Good movement right there by Derek Taylor. He slapped it right to John Williams. Nobody on the other end. He just goes up and slams it through.
So possession gives the ball to LSU. With the score tied.
Mark Price working against Derek Taylor, who's awfully quick. Working his way in to try to penetrate. Tough shot, but he makes it.
Well, that was a tough shot, Dick. You're absolutely right. Price was all over him.
Taylor having his best year in LSU. Regains the lead. Biggest lead for each side has been 4 points.
Starts to take really looking more to the inside. Now to Salley, who had that first half early spurt. Here's Price.
Mark Price hitting 53% from the field. As Price goes, so goes Georgia Tech, and it's a 16-16 game. Redden leads LSU with 8 points. They still retain possession of the ball. Salley has six. And there's the big man you were talking about on the right coming off the bench, 7 foot Antoine Ford, the sophomore from Manhattan, who's an improving big man. He comes in.
You know, Bobby Crimmins has really built an interesting club, Dick. He's got a mixture of New Yorkers and Southerners right here.
Blanton inside. Misses, and Williams on the follow-up. John Williams with 4 points.
There are people who will tell you he may be the best player for his size in the country. There are a number of good 6'8 players around the country.
He can get a rebound. He can bring the ball up. He can get boards, hit outside, play inside. Salley finds Farrell, and a foul called against John Williams, his second personal foul, so LSU's got to watch out for foul trouble with their horse, their big man.
And you know, he made two really, I think, not really smart fouls. He got the guy and he slapped him across the arm as he started up.
Antoine Ford is limping, coming over to the bench to Bobby Crimmins. So they're going to bring back Tom Hammonds. Salley is in there. They try to go with the 2 7-footers, but Ford is shaken up, and now Tom Hammonds, who's at 6'8", comes back into the ballgame.
Dick, he's holding his right ankle. I'm just wondering if he didn't sprain his ankle when he came down the floor on that trip.
Georgia Tech inbound. Loose ball. LSU has it.
The fumble by Hammonds created that whole problem because they went back to Farrell, who was standing out of bounds.
Nearly halfway through this opening half. LSU leading Georgia Tech 18-16. Dick Stockton and Larry Conley here in the sold-out Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. John Williams gets a second chance. And Georgia Tech coming down with it, barely saving it. Price. Williams wants to make sure he doesn't get in Price's way with two fouls. And going in all the way, Dalrymple misses the layup inside. Oliver Brown will be coming in for the Tigers in just a moment. Derek Taylor fires away.
And again, he made a tough shot over Mark Price, who was right in his face.
Derek Taylor having his best year and the top playmaker for LSU. Now the yellow pom-poms from Georgia Tech are out to see whether Tech can come back here. 4 points down. Salley feeds inside, Hammonds off his hands. Loose ball, Farrell inside. Great hustle by Georgia Tech.
I don't know how Dalrymple got that ball to Farrell. There was nothing but legs between he and Farrell, and he still got it to him.
All five Tech starters are in double figures and all shooting over 50%. Three of them at 60%. Taylor missing outside. And Anthony Wilson, the other guard, gets the rebound for LSU. Redden picked up quickly by Farrell. Williams up on high.
But what Price post inside, trying to work against Wilson.
Redden misses. And Redden was looking for the foul, didn't get it. Wilson is trying to work on Price inside. And the two of them are really scrapping. Hammond in the lane gets the basket. And another tie, 20-20.
Dick, you know, Dale Brown's off the bench calling his defensive right now. And that time he called the cross arms, which is their basically one guy on man-to-man or two guys man-to-man. He wanted one man on Price, but Dalrymple saw it and got it to Hammond.
Anthony Wilson misses it, and the rebound by Farrell. And we'll have traveling called against Georgia Tech. Dalrymple, Oliver Brown, the junior from Baton Rouge, will come in, and the pace remains fierce.
Effort. It's what separates one company from another. Effort. It's what it takes to stay ahead. Effort. It's the difference between a job and a job well done. Effort. It's what makes Hilton America's business address.
Have you looked at Allstate homeowners insurance rates lately?
Nope.
They may be lower than you think.
They are low.
Leave it to the good hands, people. Leave it to the good hands, people.
Bring your policy into Allstate and compare. See how low our rates really are.
Leave it to the good hands, people.
They're low.
You're in good hands with Allstate.
A member of the Sears Financial Network.
This Friday, a neighborly word to the wise. Be careful who you listen to.
Don't ask any questions.
In the Twilight Zone.
Bobby Kremins is kind of a man on the spot with a big burden after Georgia Tech lost to Georgetown last year in the regional final. Everyone said Georgia Tech is going to be really the team to watch. They have played well, Larry, 27-6. But there's a lot of pressure on them because the chemistry hasn't been all there, and they're trying to live up to the reputation they set for themselves last year.
Well, you know, Dick, this used to be an also-ran type of club. People played Georgia Tech because they got an automatic win. Bobby Kremins came here. The club he took over was 4-23. What he's built is a nationally prominent basketball program, and now that pressure has begun to transfer over to him, and also the fans are putting the pressure on him.
But so far, Tech in the tournament has been playing more not to lose than to go out and try to win, and that's been their big problem. Taylor controlling. We've had six ties in this game. Blanton looking for Wilson. Georgia Tech playing much tighter now against the outside shooters of LSU.
We played almost 12 minutes of basketball, and they haven't gone out of their man-to-man defense. They stayed with it.
Oliver Brown, who came into the ball game, good defensive stopper. They rarely rely on him for offensive capabilities. 12 on the shot clock. Redden looks inside. He finds Blanton tipped away, and Farrell makes a great play. Over to Salley. Farrell got the tip, saved the ball, and kept it into the hands of Georgia Tech. Mark Price hits to the side.
Oh, yeah. He's lighting it up now.
Six for Mark Price. And Georgia Tech leads. We've had four lead changes, and the turnover story still favors LSU. Blanton hits from outside. Out of Miami of Florida. He's made himself a tough player with tremendous weight training, and that's why he starts at center for LSU.
6'7 and 228, going up against a 7-footer and John Salley.
Inside, Salley beats him and is fouled. It'll be Anthony Wilson with the foul for Louisiana State.
Anthony Wilson was a little upset with that call right there, but he got John Salley as he started up.
Dick Stockton and Larry Conley here at the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. Capacity crowd, an enthusiastic one at that, watching this tight, taut duel between LSU, the underdog, seeded number 11 in the region, and Georgia Tech, seeded second. And we're in a dead tie, and Salley misses the first free throw.
I think I was in the Omni this afternoon, and Georgia Tech came out to shoot. And you know who was helping them practice their shooting? Mark Price's dad.
Well, if you're a son of a coach, find a coach wherever you can to help you out. That's the time remaining in the first half. Georgia Tech leading by one. Biggest lead for either side was 4 points. Blanton keeps his head, holds on to the ball.
Good help by Dalrymple that side getting in there.
Wilson baseline. Try to draw the foul. And is picked off inside by Dalrymple over to Mark Price again. Dalrymple feeding to Farrell. Inside, Hammonds got three.
Good look by Farrell. He caught him on the inside. I think LSU was confused on defenses. And the ball went inside, and Hammond was wide open.
That's kind of understandable with all the defenses they throw at him. Derek Taylor coming back and misses. Farrell. And Georgia Tech on a 9-2 run. Looking to increase their lead, and they'll call offensive foul against Wayne Farrell, his first of the game.
Good move by Anthony Wilson. He got in perfect position to draw it. Watch the lob. This was the play earlier. Georgia Tech got an easy basket. LSU somewhat confused on defense. Hammond wasn't on offense.
Shooting LSU, considering they're 37% and Georgia Tech 55, they're not doing all too bad trailing by three, are they?
You're shooting 37%, you're down three. Something's going right for you.
6 minutes to go in the first half. Looking for Blanton and Redden inside now. Not much height on LSU's team, but as long as they got the sharpshooters like Redden, who has 10, they'll hang in there. Redden, 5 out of 9 from the field.
Okay, two fists up now. Dale Brown's gone to a 2-3 zone.
Changing the defenses. That's what saved us, Dale Brown told us yesterday. Mark Price, short. tipped up into the hands of Derek Taylor. Taylor with a good feed to Oliver Brown, and the basket counts and a foul, and LSU has regained the lead 26-25.
Dick, that's the way you run the fast break. You fill the lanes when the guy gets the ball, gets it in there, and he makes the good pass. Price with a miss, a little bit of a tip. Watch Dallin Rimple go down right here. That opened it up. Good dish to the other side. Derek Taylor got it to Brown, and he laid it in, and Price committed the foul.
First foul on Price, and here is Oliver Brown, who has that great sixth sense, they say, defensively, averaging only 2.5 points a game, but he surpassed that with a three-point play to give LSU the lead by two.
Every time it looks like Georgia Tech's going to make a runaway of it, LSU comes back and they fought. Now they're up by two.
Antoine Ford's ankle apparently is all right. We'll check and wait and see. Still on the bench. Dalrymple, Price, tipped away by Oliver Brown. It's still, and here comes Antoine Ford back in the ball game. Saw action early, the seven-footer, and had to come out. John Salley also comes in, so Kremen is going with two big men. Jack Mansell was in there briefly. And Frank Neal comes back in. So two seven-footers in the game now for Georgia Tech.
Pretty good idea right now by Bobby Kremens. He's going to put his big lineup in there, but he's got Dalrymple and Price, and Neal are the three good ball handlers.
Now Price goes out for the first time in the game, but he does have enough with Neal in there.
He'll really spell Dalrymple and Price at either position, because he can play the point or he can play the off guard.
And he can get you points. Under 5 minutes to go in the first half. Dalrymple, who's been ice cold from the field. Harrell tries to keep it alive. LSU has it.
LSU doing a great job on the defensive glass. They're not letting Georgia Tech get second and third shots.
Look how many more shots LSU has had than Georgia Tech. And they're going to call the foul against Redden, I believe, and that'll be number two on Don Redden, who's LSU's top scorer with 10 points.
Watch at the top of the screen. He just simply pushes him over right here. A little bit of an acting job, too.
That's part of the game. Timeout with 4:35 remaining in the first half.
The right parts. Mr. Goodwrench has the right parts for your GM car. Parts that fit. Parts engineered for your car by people who designed your car. Parts for every make and every model of virtually every GM car and light truck on the road today. Mr. Goodwrench can help you keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM parts, because no one knows your GM car better. No one.
This is today's Chevrolet Camaro.
Saturday night, USA. Heartbeat pumping, time to play.
Camaro's waiting for you.
LSU has a two-point lead in a close game. We've had seven ties and six lead changes. 4:35 remaining. Now you want to talk about the toughest schedules, and a lot of what the NCAA decides is based on strength of schedule. And LSU really has not played the toughest of all schedules. In fact, they are 47th compared to this schedule, and Georgia Tech the toughest. Of course, that's because of the ACC.
I think right now LSU probably playing the number one team as far as the NCAA is concerned, the toughest schedule, finding out that LSU's pretty good, and Southeastern Conference seems to be pretty good right now.
Georgia Tech with the ball, trailing by two with 4.5 minutes to go in the first half. Hammonds and Price with six. Salley, though, leads with seven. He's in the game along with Antoine Ford, 2 7-footers. Salley leads Ford off his hand. Taylor beating Anthony Wilson, who pulls up. Wilson gets his own rebound. Taylor. And this time, Ford, the rebound for Georgia Tech.
Taylor was not a very good shot right there, and I thought on the other end, Salley should have taken his shot instead of making that pass. Sometimes you can overpass the ball, Dick. If you've got the shot from 8 feet, take it.
Salley started off like a house of fire with two big dunk slams, has 7 points now. Farrell inside the Ford, and a foul. Oliver Brown wasn't going to let Antoine Ford get an easy two.
And he did. He made sure of that. He really put the handcuffs on him. He got near that rim, and about that time, Brown came up and just locked him up.
North Carolina leading Louisville 31-25 in Houston in the first half. Notice how Salley has kind of disappeared from that opening crescendo in this game.
He really has. The first 2.5 to 3 minutes, he looked like a world beater. He's just gone into hiding. We haven't seen him anywhere.
Ford is a 63% shooter. There's John Salley, who took on added responsibility this year when he moved over from forward to center when Yvonne Joseph graduated. Ford missed both, but we may have a lane violation, and we do against LSU, so Ford's going to get another chance.
Dick, I want to go back to that point about Georgia Tech losing Yvonne Joseph. I think that was a crucial loss for them. He was a big, physical, intimidating player. I don't think Georgia Tech has a big, physical, intimidating player. Salley can't play that role, but Joseph did.
Right, and the closest man is Hammonds, who's just a freshman, who came on and gave him some power himself. Well, because of the lane violation, Ford had the extra free throw made good, and LSU's lead cut to 1. 3:45 are leading in the first half. But LSU has shown up very well here, playing in Atlanta. Larry Conley pointed out, not quite the home advantage he feels. Redden will get fouled and go to the line, and LSU has acted like maybe they're still in Baton Rouge.
Yeah, there are some guys that really take the basketball, want it, and want to be creative with it. I think Don Redden is one of those kind of players. You get it to him, he's going to make something happen.
And an outstanding free throw shooter at 87%, and this will only be the second attempt from the line coming up for LSU. What a good form on the shot from the senior from Monroe, Louisiana. Craig Neal back in the ball game for Georgia Tech. He's pretty good under pressure on the line late in the game.
Talk about free throw percentage. This guy right here led the Southeastern Conference in free throw percentage this year.
One out of two, but Oliver Brown keeps it alive for LSU.
Well, if you're going to miss one, make sure it comes back to you.
Long range shot is good. Don Redden has 13 points in the ball game now, and LSU has matched its biggest lead, 4 points, 30-26, with 3:20 to play in the half.
Boy, LSU is really playing well, Dick.
Inside they go to Farrell, and Farrell muscles his way in for two.
Farrell a little bit quicker than Blanton on the inside, and that's the reason he got it. Blanton did not make that adjustment defensively. Farrell blew right by him.
Keep in mind, starting center Blanton is really a guard. Redden, ball slapped away by Price. Out of bounds, still LSU ball.
Good heads up play. Watch Redden right here. Brown comes back, gets the long rebound, saves it, and that kept LSU in the game. Redden gets it, taps it around for a while, and throws it up, and he made it.
Blanton is trapped by Salley, the seven-footer. Wilson from the corner. Anthony Wilson. He really got his confidence going and has had his best scoring days down the stretch. He started 11 games, a good passer, but the 25 against Purdue in the game winner has helped him. Neal comes back for Georgia Tech.
They started out the half with a fast pace. It looks like they're going to finish it at 4.
There's the time remaining. And Georgia Tech called for the foul, the 16th foul against Georgia Tech. Mark Price, his second personal. Leading scorers in the ball game, Redden with that great outside shot. Salley, most of the damage inside early. Anthony Wilson, the guard at 6'4", leads everyone with 8 rebounds. So they're crashing the boards, the Tigers are.
They're doing everything right so far.
LSU leading by 2, 2:10 to go in the first half, and plenty of time on the shot clock.
Like Dale Brown's asked his club to pull the ball out a little bit and slow the momentum of this game.
You know what else, Larry? They've done a lot of this without John Williams on the bench. He's been on the bench with 4 points and 2 fouls. Wilson misses outside, and the rebound knocked away from Farrell into the hands of the Tigers again, and that's why they've gotten so many more shots than Georgia Tech so far.
I tell you who saved it was Blanton. He's the one that slapped it away.
Pesky player. Gutty, heady performer. And Derek Taylor will go to the line shooting two. Looks like LSU knows how to get into position to get fouled if they don't make the shot.
Well, Taylor's very good at that. He's a good one-on player, as is Redden. Both of those guys will try to take you as we look at the West Regional in the first half.
Tight game as we expected between the Tar Heels And the Louisville Cardinals, 35-33, Carolina leading. Here's John Williams, who has 4 points and two personal fouls, spending most of the second part of his half on the bench. But why get him back in there? LSU's playing well.
Hey, they'll change things if it's going well for you. Exactly. And Dale Brown realizes that.
Taylor hits the first free throw. Both teams are in the bonus.
You know, Ricky Blanton, LSU, is probably the most unlikely-looking basketball player you'd ever want to see. But he really comes out and really fills a good role for these Fighting Tigers.
He did a great job against Bedford and Memphis State and has been a pesky defender so far in this game. Two free throws by Taylor. And LSU up again by four. 1:36 to go in the half. Price. And Redden gets position on the 7'4" to get the rebound.
Dick, I think Price is about a step outside of his range.
The rebounding story is almost even, which is a surprise considering LSU doesn't have the size Tech does. Price is 2 for 5, by the way, when you want to talk about where his range is. Redden tries to draw the foul, get the basket, gets Peter, and Salley knocks it out of bounds. He just swatted that ball away, so LSU still maintains the ball.
Surprised he didn't just reach up and pull it down and grab it. You don't want to slap a ball like that. That went up into almost the third row.
Out to Blanton. Taylor and Wilson, very poised, sharp guards for LSU. They've rotated their front court effectively. Here's Anthony Wilson. The rebound by Salley. Got good position to Neal in the forecourt. First rebound for John Salley, who led the team in that department. 44 seconds to go. Price. And Taylor wins the battle inside. 38 seconds to go, and LSU can play for the last shot, leading by four.
Well, Price has gone ice cold in the first half.
He's had games like this.
LSU going into a little bit of a weave now, Dick. They're going to run it on the outside, run that shot clock.
Don Redden taking it into the corner. They spread it out. No one in the middle. Watch the clock. Remaining in the first half, LSU will have the lead. And the 11th seed team trying to spin some more magic. Derek Taylor hits with 6 seconds to go. And Georgia Tech with Mark Price. Last shot. That's the end of the first half. And Dale Brown's LSU Tigers lead Bobby Crevins, who's heads down. And that's the end of the first half of the score. LSU 36, Georgia Tech 30. CBS Sports coverage will continue after the message and a word from your local station.
An idea can happen anytime. When you work for Hewlett-Packard, you don't just sell business computing systems, you solve problems. So when you have an idea, you do something about it. You never stop asking, what if?
You know that electronic mail project for the bank? What if we used HP methods?
Once upon a time, far across the great ocean, there flew a gleaming carriage on the wings of birds. The carriage was called United, and the people who flew in it were happy, for everywhere the carriage flew, the skies were friendly. But people were sad, too. Why cannot we fly through friendly skies to other side of great ocean? Then one day, a new wind blew. It blew and blew the friendly skies from all 50 states to our land. To Beijing, Shanghai, Osaka, Tokyo, Melbourne, Sydney, Seoul, Manila, Auckland, Singapore, Taipei, Bangkok, Hong Kong. Welcome, gleaming carriage of United. United's Royal Pacific Service, truly a fresh breeze across the Pacific.
You're not just flying, you're flying with friendly skies.
Friday on Dallas. Will Pam deny JR his lifelong dream? Total control of Ewing Oil.
You can hang on, and we'll be button heads for the rest of our days.
This is CBS.
Only one husband in 100 has done what I've done. I've talked to the people here at P.J. McMahon about prearranged funeral plans for my wife and me. I feel good about it because they have a fine reputation, and they've served the folks in New Orleans for 5 generations. And McMahon's beautiful home is right here in my neighborhood. course, I'm not about to need their services anytime soon. My wife and I are celebrating our 40th anniversary this year, and we wouldn't miss that for anything.
P.J. McMahon and Sons Funeral Home, a name you can trust for your family's security.
Lunch, huh?
Nice.
Is that really giving you everything you need? Ah, but then you're in a hurry. What if I told you about a quick drink that would turn that hamburger into a full meal? With more than half your recommended daily allowance of protein and calcium, and a third of your daily iron needs. Not to mention a healthy supply of vitamins and nutrients. Oh, I see. Nice lunch.
All right, Bill. Also, right now going on a Final Four caliber matchup in Houston. That's North Carolina and Louisville. And the Cardinals lead by two, under a minute to go in the first half. Earlier tonight, in the West Regional Semifinal, Auburn came from behind to upend UNLV by seven. Tigers off to a shaky start. They trailed by 14 in the first half, but they came back mainly by dominating the boards. Look at Chuck Person. He had 25.
Against St. John's, he shot the ball well outside. A tower of strength inside.
And they await the winner now of Louisville and North Carolina in the West Final on Saturday. Coming up this weekend on CBS Sports Saturday and Sports Sunday, exclusive coverage of the 1986 World Figure Skating Championships. And our John Tesh filed this report from Geneva, Switzerland.
Here at the World Figure Skating Championships, U.S. National Champion Debbie Thomas has suddenly found herself in a position to win the gold medal. And another American, Tiffany Chin, has also proved that she too has a chance for a medal here. Chin beginning to tell a personal comeback story of enormous proportions. Both 18-year-old Americans locked in a battle with the woman who has struck gold at the world's twice before, the East German ice maiden, Katharina Witt. Well, in her short program last night, Tiffany Chin showed us all that the rumors of her demise in this sport have been greatly exaggerated. The intensity of the competition read on the face of Debbie Thomas. And maybe it was that intensity that proved to be too much for Witt, as she missed an important move in her short program. This was not a performance worthy of the Olympic champion. The queen of the ice last night was Debbie Thomas. Thomas, juggling a figure skating career with one as a freshman at Stanford University, where she studies pre-medicine. Wednesday night's surgery was performed on the rest of the field as Debbie won the short program.
And John Tesh and company will have their coverage of the competition this Saturday and Sunday at a special time, noon Eastern, here on CBS. And the road to the Final Four will continue here on CBS in just a moment.
This is a revolutionary advancement in shaving from Gillette Research. The brush. Gillette announces Brush Plus. A shaving concentrate and brush in one. A brush to lift your whiskers with the soothing warmth only a brush can give you. A concentrate with extra softeners and lubricants that are massaged deep into your beard for a shave that is superior. Brush Plus from Gillette for a superior shave.
8 long years of development are over. Introducing the new Mercedes-Benz 300E. It moves from 0 to 55 in a stunning 7.5 seconds. It moves performance sedan engineering into a new dimension. And it returns to zero with computerized ABS anti-lock brakes. The new 300E sedan.
It's getting dark. You and Timmy better be heading home.
Dad, what are you worried about?
You don't want to be out at night with your old car.
The car may be old, but it's got Michelin.
Michelin radios? That's a lot of money for a tire.
Dad, the way I see it, at 10 p.m. on a lonely road, it's a lot of tire for the money.
Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Baseball at Yale was really a great experience. I had one of the great coaches of all time, and that was Red Rahl, former third baseman, New York Yankees. And he made no bones about it. You either performed academically or you were not on the team. So the incentive was to pay attention to my engineering courses, which I did, and then to get out to practice after I did my academic work. I tried out for third base, which is what I played in high school, and after he watched me desecrate the hot corner, because he was an all-star third baseman. He said, Bobby, I'm going to put you out in left field. And I said, why is that, Red? And he said, well, the way you play third base, that's where most of the balls are going to wind up anyway. If I had not participated in sports, I don't think I would have done as well academically. My experience in, at the university would not have been as full as it was.
This message furnished by the NCAA.
The surprise team of this tournament, without a doubt, has been Cleveland State. And as Bill Raftery found out this week, that much maligned city has been trying to bask in the sudden success of Kevin Mackey's Vikings.
The best things in life are right here in Cleveland. There are friendly people near. Getting around is easy here. We're a town where great things happen all year.
But for Cleveland sports fans, great things haven't happened for 22 years when the football Browns last won the NFL championship and the baseball Indians haven't done much to pick up the slack. While the Cavaliers disappoint season after season in the NBA.
Sports fans in Cleveland aren't the only ones suffering. The city itself has been the butt of many jokes, such as the mistake on the lake. But thanks to a great basketball team here at Cleveland State University, things might be changing.
The team's success so far comes from their intense, every man after the ball, nonstop effort. It's a 40-minute game plan orchestrated by head coach Kevin Mackey, who says it gets the maximum from his players and makes it tough for the other guy.
Our style of play is different. I think our approach is different with 10 kids. The fact that kids play so hard, they're so happy to be here. They've been so long out of the spotlight, they really relish it.
I thought my time was due. I see all the guys I played against on television every week. And I go to Cleveland State, who don't never get any pub until we make it to the NCAAs.
But now the publicity and the pressure are magnified beyond what this normally quiet, mostly commuter campus is used to. Expectations for this weekend are running high, and the players have to deal with it.
It's good in some aspects, but then it's bad. You know, right now I think we just need to concentrate on winning and leaving the celebration until after it's all over.
Well, it's, you're only halfway home. You got a couple of games left.
Well, you know, we're not used to all this exposure. We're just the quiet team that goes out and gets the job done. And, you know, we just like to stay that way for three more games.
They've been called Mackey's Misfits, but maybe the mouse can pull anchor on the Naval Academy.
I'll tell you, that's an exciting team to watch. And you'll see Cleveland State in action tomorrow night against David Robinson and Navy, another surprise team. That game will be shown at 12:30 Eastern Time. Now, those of you in Cleveland and Maryland will see the game live at 7 p.m. Later tonight at 11:30, we'll have delayed coverage of Alabama and Kentucky, who played down in Atlanta. The road to the Final Four will continue on CBS Sports in just a moment.
Man, skiing sure is fun. You run into lots of nice people out there.
Yeah, we ran into Quirky yesterday.
That's for sure.
And afterwards, there's nothing like a warm fire.
Oh, I'll see.
And a cold Miller Lite. Light really tastes great.
And it's less filling. And us hot doggers don't like to get filled up. Speaking of hot dogs, where's Euchre?
Euchre.
Great seats, hey, buddy? Hey, where are all the guys? They're missing all the fun.
For great taste, there's only one light beer, Miller Lite.
Are you anything like my brother Jack? He figured the only way to get into a serious road car was to go empty his bank account and buy something from the Black Forest. But I talked him into driving a Mazda 626. Now he's going around telling everyone he knows about refinements, like the better aerodynamics, the new fuel injection, and the great performance. But the way I figured, I saved old Jack about $7,000. Do you think I'll ever see any of it?
No way.
That's what I thought.
Nearly 80 million people have the security of health care coverage when and where they need it. They couldn't picture their lives without it. Could you?
Dear, beloved Uncle Dwight. He certainly had a lot of friends.
The Pruitts drove all the way from Alaska.
What?
Alaska.
Oh, Alaska. I counted license plates from 18 different states.
Hey, Earl, what kind of motor oil do you use?
Motor oil is motor oil.
What?
Motor oil is motor oil.
Oh, yes, he is.
Motor oil definitely is not motor oil. Four-cylinder cars work harder and need specially formulated Valvoline 4-Guard. Don't drive your car to an early grave.
You know, it's tough growing up these days, but I don't need anyone's pity. I do my best, I make my own decisions, and one thing I've decided is to stay away from drugs. Life's difficult enough without drugs messing up my mind. I know sometimes the pressure gets tough and it's hard to say no, but I've got friends and my teammates to back me up. You've got to say no if you want to get ahead. And it's important to find friends who will back up your decision to say no to drugs. After all, you can't be a hit when you're high.
Something to think about from the NCAA.
Back at the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia Tech led by 3 with 6.5 minutes to go, and then LSU outscored the Yellow Jackets 14-5. DeForge in front 36-30. Here's how they did it. Now, looking at the shooting, Georgia Tech is 50%, LSU 40%, but look at the difference. 16 more shots by LSU, and here's why. They've done the job off the offensive glass. 12 second chance, 12 rebounds, 12 second chance points. Look what Georgia Tech has. And add on to that the turnover situation, which heavily favors LSU, and now you know why. The Tigers, trying to spin an upset, have a 6-point lead at halftime.
And Dick, here's one of the reasons, the offensive rebounding, and also the loose balls that they've come up with. Look at their long carom here. LSU got it back. There's one of those second chance baskets that they had an opportunity to get. But it's also been their defense that's been able to turn it for them. They got it here, another turnover. They got it from Price. Got a basket right here. John Williams with the stuff.
Interesting enough, Larry, John Williams has spent most of the half on the bench, and Mark Price has taken twice as many shots as any Georgia Tech player this year, 2-for-6 from the field.
His ineffectiveness from the offensive end, and also Dale Brown's recognition to see that, hey, I've got things going well my way. I'm not going to put Williams back in the game. Smart play.
All right, we'll see how Bobby Kremins adjusts. And CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
My daughter came out to visit, and the guys at Mazda lent me this 323 for her to drive. She knew right away it wasn't just another small car, because it's more like a small road car. It's smooth, quiet, solid, and roomy. I even told her, if she wanted to get one with her own money, what a good deal it is. I'm really glad she's grown up to be sensible and practical, just like her old man.
Yeah, right, Dad.
Who says you can't have light beer with super premium taste? Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Super premium taste and a less filling beer.
Michelob Light. Oh, yes, you can. Have it all.
This is CBS.
New Popeye's Cajun Popcorn
Ain't
Shrimp.
Ain't no cooking like Cajun.
Ain't no cooking.
Ain't no cooking that good.
No, 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 no.
And it ain't no Cajun like Popeye.
Like Popeye.
It tastes like Cajun should. Love that chicken from Popeye. Fights it through and through.
Popeye's Cajun Popcorn Shrimp. Shrimp made the Popeye's way with that special blend of Cajun seasoning. Pop in and try some today. It's Popeye's Cajun Popcorn Shrimp.
Now at Adler's, elegant and distinctive diamonds and 14-karat gold Omega watches, unbelievably priced at $1,000. Adler's.
Tonight's Southeast Regional semifinal game is sponsored by MasterCard. MasterCard International, master the possibilities. Today's Chevrolet, who invite you to live the style, performance, and fun of Chevrolet in 86. And by Michelob Light, super premium taste and less filling beer.
We're set to go. Bobby Kremins on the bench for Georgia Tech, and Dale Brown, one half away from Another surprise in this NCAA tournament. Unusual that the leading rebounds are guards, Price and Anthony Wilson.
I want to tell you, Dick, right now LSU looks like a team that wants to win. They want to win. I don't think Tech does right now at this point.
Price, 2 for 6, misses his first shot. Burrell tries to tip it in. There's Hammond. So Georgia Tech wants to get into the battle on the offensive glass, and they do there.
Well, that was a good start. Hammond's coming in and getting that first one for them.
LSU leading. They know what North Carolina State did 3 years ago. Anyone can win when you get hot. John Williams, who has 13 points. Rebound. Check that, 4 for John Williams.
What a tough move missed by Dalrymple right there. He had a wide open layup, and Price got in the basketball, and he couldn't make it.
John Redden leads with 13. Salley is the high scorer for Tech with 7. Derek Taylor working.
Good help that time by Dalrymple on Taylor.
John Williams, double team, leaving Anthony Wilson open from the corner. Short, Hammond position. Here's Mark Price. Taylor is back defensively, but Price goes in anyway. Good play by Mark Price.
Dick, that's one thing he can really do. He can accelerate. He can be going at a certain speed and all of a sudden put it in second gear and really kick it.
4 straight points by Georgia Tech to start out the second half, and they need that.
And it was a good start by Salley and Price, the two guys that have led them all year and for the last 4 years.
At halftime, North Carolina and Louisville are tied up at 43. That's in the West Regional in Houston. John Williams. Williams with only 4 points in the ball game and 2 for 10 shooting, and Georgia Tech can tie it up here.
Well, that brought the crowd to their feet.
Tech is 3-3 when they've trailed at halftime this year. That's 3 of their 6 losses have occurred when they've been behind after 20 minutes. Salley from Dalrymple, and we have another tie.
How about a timeout? I think they need one.
That's what Dale Brown has just signaled his team.
Here to understand performance, the car has either got it or it doesn't. Now, if having more driving fun makes sense to you, you're gonna like Mazda 626. It's got a slick new computer-controlled fuel injection system that gives you a bunch more horsepower to play with. But you can always try to tell yourself the real reason you want it is its good looks and great value.
And forget the performance?
I said you could try.
10 years ago, Xerox invented a technology that changed printing forever. Lasography. Producing razor-sharp images at incredible speeds, the laser printer was destined to be on every desk in America. There was, however, one minor drawback. So Xerox developed the 4045 Laser CP. And again, razor-sharp images, remarkable speed. And it doesn't look ridiculous sitting on your desk.
For laser-sharp documents, call Team Xerox.
The premier field in tournament golf, one of the tour's most challenging courses, the Tournament Players Championship. Coverage begins March 28th on CBS Sports.
We're tied, and Georgia Tech trailing 36-30 has scored 6 in a row, and they've gone to their big man who started the first half that way.
And Dick, actually, when he started like that, the beginning of the second half, just like the first half, that's John Salley. But the question now is, will he disappear in the second half the way he did in the first half? If he doesn't, Tech's got a great shot at winning this one.
LSU with the ball. We have had 8 ties. 6 times the lead has changed hands. Redden to Blanton up on top. Hammonds is guarding him. Man-to-man defense for Georgia Tech. Into the hands of John Williams. They want to get him underway. He's struggling. But Anthony Wilson is there on the baseline, and he has kept this team alive off the board. And now Anthony Wilson has scored 6.
And Dick, is another one of those loose balls that LSU's been coming up with through this whole basketball game.
Burrell in the lane from behind. Taylor got a piece of it. He's ahead of the field. And Derek Taylor gives LSU the 4-point lead. And so that timeout was a fortuitous one for Dale Brown.
Wilson.
Anthony Wilson calls a timeout, or is called with a foul. And the signals of the defense come from Dale Brown. That's three personal fouls on Anthony Wilson.
He has a bewildered look on his face. He turned around to the official and says, are you sure you got the right guy? Dale Brown up there with his arms crossed. In their terminology, that's a defense where either one or two person plays man-to-man and the other three or four play a zone. Let's see what they do this trip down the floor.
All right, you saw Oliver Brown come in the ball game for LSU.
Okay, they've got a double team out of the 2-3 right now. Dalrymple and Price on the outside, and there's a foul by Brown.
Now Salley coming across, and for Brown, that's his second personal foul.
Dick, we really didn't have the opportunity to look at that defensive change right there because the ball went inside so quickly. If Georgia Tech is able to recognize the changes in those defenses as they did right here on the good pass by Dalrymple to Salley, they're going to be in great shape because LSU does change often.
And in the first half, they didn't change as much as they'd like because Georgia Tech got back in a hurry, and so they stayed mostly in that 2-3 zone.
Well, I think the ball movement really was a hindrance to them. They couldn't get their defenses changed.
LSU leading 40-36. Salley up on top. Price, top of the key, misses. Salley gets the rebound, fights his way in, and calls for the offensive foul as he knocks Ricky Blanton to the floor. That'll be the third foul.
Salley really had nowhere to go.
Two fouls on Salley. Two on Salley.
Not a very popular call here in Atlanta.
LSU has stood up against the home crowd advantage. Williams has his shot blocked by Salley. That's the way to do it. Into the hands of Tech. Price feeding Salley. Good pass inside Dalrymple. And you wonder whether Salley made that extra pass unnecessarily in there.
Well, again, he passed up another shot. He had the opportunity for the short shot and gave it up to Dalrymple. Watch it right here. Is that Farrell? Farrell got a piece of that basketball, and he slapped it, got it right in the hands of Mark Price. Watch Price down the right side. He comes down. Sally's got it. Salley gives it to Dalrymple. No. You're 7 feet from that position. You take it up, and you jam it.
Oliver Brown's third personal foul. So Brown and Anthony Wilson each with three. And here is Bruce Dalrymple, 65% shooter from the line. Georgia Tech has out-rebounded LSU.
Rebounding Tech coming back now in the second half after being almost decimated in the first half.
He missed them both to Dalrymple and missed a chance to bring Tech to within two. So with 4 minutes gone by in the second half, LSU with the lead and the ball. Redden goes up and is fouled. Redden has the ability to hang in there and get rid of the ball and get fouled on the elbow. Farrell right there, and that's three on Farrell. So he becomes the first Georgia Tech player with three fouls.
I think I continue to go back and talk about this, but Redden is really a very creative player when it comes to offense. He can shoot that from that range, but he also is quick on his feet. He goes to that basket very quickly.
And Ricky Blanton, the other guards playing up front. Blanton is creative defensively.
Like I told you, start of the second half, this looks like a hungry team. They look lean. They look like they're ready to win this basketball game.
Last year, they lost to Navy in the first round. Their best showing in the championships was in 1981 when they lost to Indiana in the national semifinal. One out of two for Redden. 41-36, a five-point lead. Farrell finds Hammonds wide open outside, and Hammonds hit. Three-point lead for LSU. 11th seed in the region. Unheralded. Taylor misses. And Hammonds, the rebound for Georgia Tech. They have a 4-on-3. And Farrell tried that extra pass. And now LSU ahead of the field. Redden. Hammonds back to front. And they're going to call the foul on Hammonds. And it looked like he got a lot of the ball, but maybe the body got Redden.
I can guarantee you he got a lot of the ball. He grabbed it. He cradled it.
Let's see if his body fouled Redden.
Watch Redden now. Good pass right here. He's going to go in. He looks at Hammond. Looked at him right in the eye. Boy, he did. He got him all with a body. But he got a lot of ball, too.
Yes, he did. Brown expresses its displeasure as Redden will go to the line. Hammond's first foul of the game. Each team with three team fouls in the second half. And if they keep sending Redden to the line, Bobby Crementier will get grayer, 87% from the line. And Redden looking for his 16th point of the game.
You know, this young man just practiced for the first time last week. He had a deep thigh bruise, which kept him out of practice.
16 for Redden. 43-38 in favor of LSU. Fifth in the SEC, Southeastern Conference, with four survivors going into the round of 16.
LSU now the Fighting Tigers in the 2-3 zone. Georgia Tech trying to attack it to the inside.
Hammond coming off the screen hit. Two in a row for Hammond. Normally they don't count on his offense. They may need it here.
You know, Dick, sometimes you get into tournament play and the guys have been leading you all year long disappear, and some guy comes from out of nowhere. Maybe it's Hammond's for Georgia Tech.
Dalrymple is all over Redden and is called for the foul. That'll be his third. Bruce Dalrymple from St. Johnsbury, Vermont. Bobby Kremins is looking at an LSU team that's not about to fizzle out here from the looks of things. 43-40 in favor of the Tigers. All over Redden now is Dalrymple. Open is Williams shooting over Hammond. Williams remains ice cold in the game. Salley gets it out to Price. Back on defense is Derek Taylor. Price goes up and smartly draws the foul. Taylor's first personal of the game.
Taylor has that mocking laugh on his face right there as if he was just had, because Price took it in on him very quickly.
Hank Nichols, one of the three officials working the game, along with Tom O'Neill and John Clardy.
Dale Brown right there conferring with Ron Abernathy, his assistant coach.
Dale Brown, the senior coach in the Southeast Conference now.
And it hardly moved.
Enid, Oklahoma, literally the choir boy. Go out to the church in Marietta, you can hear him sing tenor. Right now, he's trying to bring Georgia Tech back. 1-point lead for LSU. Louisville has opened up a 12-point lead over North Carolina. The two SEC teams, two ACC teams, I should say, trailing here.
Georgia Tech now has changed defenses. They've gone away from their man-to-man. They've gone straight up zone defense. Burrell on the point. Looks like a 1-2-2.
Redden over Price. Redden got it out nicely by Oliver Brown.
Kicking another loose ball that LSU was able to come up with.
Amazing that John Williams has scored only 4 points. 2 of 13 from the field. And he's now missed 8 in a row as John Williams for LSU. And Georgia Tech can take the lead here.
Those misses are beginning to take the toll now, because LSU's been able to reduce that deficit with a chance now to go ahead.
Burrell. Oliver Brown gets a big rebound. LSU right now cannot count on John Williams. He has been ice cold from the field and not really a factor off the glass either.
Dale Brown now shouting instructions to his club. They saw that defense the last time and he was the zone, and they see it again, so they're going to change their offense.
13:05 remaining in the second half. LSU clinging to a 1-point lead. They're led by 6 at the half.
Dick, I'm wondering if Dale Brown's strategy right now is to hold that ball to the final 10 seconds of the 45-second shot clock before he starts it.
That's not their style.
Now, they like to go up and down the floor, but it looks like he's going to hold it out. He's got 10 now.
Taylor signals the play. You're right, now they're going for it. 3 seconds. Taylor misses the shot outside. That's not the shot you want if you wait all that time, for sure. So Georgia Tech again can take the lead.
Dale Brown with two fists up in the air that time. That's the signal for their 2-3 zone.
Price puts a fake on Taylor. High arcing shot goes. And Georgia Tech is in front again. The last time they led was at 25-24 in the first half.
Georgia Tech's going to stay with that zone defense. Let's see if Dale Brown waits to attack it.
Inside to Williams. Redden working against Dalrymple. Redden puts it up, and LSU with our 8th lead change in front again.
Dick, when you got to look for somebody, you look for the guys that led you all year, and Redden's doing that right now for LSU.
He has 18 points, 6 points over a season's average. Inside Salley, ball stripped away. And it's still Georgia Tech ball as they stepped on the line. Coming back in the ball game is Anthony Wilson, who went out with 3 personal fouls for LSU. And Oliver Brown goes out. He also has 3.
I
Notice both clubs defensively have gone straight up zone defenses. 2-3, the last four trips down the floor, both sides.
11:40 remaining. Second half. 17 on the shot clock. Hammond, Salley, Price, another one. In and out, and Blanton the rebound into the hands of Taylor. Notice that Salley has fallen back into the background from the early play of the second half as he did in the first.
Well, we talked about it. It's almost a repeat performance. He's coming back and doing it again.
LSU taking its time, and now Anthony Wilson hits from outside. An outside shooting paid off. Wilson with 8 points. And now you see Vargas getting off the bench for Louisiana State. Bobby Kremins wants a timeout. LSU leading 47-44 with 10:58 to go.
Who says you can't have 100% imported hops and a less filling beer? Old World Aging and a less filling beer. Smooth, super premium taste and a less filling beer. Michelob Light, the best of both worlds.
Michelob Light, oh yes you can. Have it all.
The horse, one of the world's most powerful domesticated animals. Now this small pickup, the tough 86 Ford Ranger STX, has harnessed unbeaten horsepower in a small pickup. Now Ranger has 140 horses under its stylish hood in a new improved V6 engine. More horsepower than even Toyota's turbo. And Ranger's 140 horses mean down-to-earth power, power to run, power for real driving fun. The Ford Ranger STX Super Cab, voted 4x4 of the year. Get 9.9% financing on new Ford Rangers.
Jim Nance in New York in that West Regional matchup. North Carolina and Louisville tied at halftime. Cardinals went on a 16-4 tear to open up the second half. Wagner behind the back to Hall. Louisville leads by 10 with 12 minutes left in the ball game. Let's go back to Dick and Larry.
Thank you very much, Jim. And tonight at 11:30 on CBS, it'll be Alabama against Kentucky in the other Southeast Regional semifinal. Now, for those of you who are not going to stay up for the game and want to see the score, turn away, and we're going to put the score up. You turned away? All right, here's the final score. It's still up. It's still up of the Southeast Regional now. We take it out, and now you can come back and enjoy the game. But we hope you watch the ball game. Quite a contest between Kentucky and Alabama meeting for the fourth time this year. 10:45 remaining in the second half. Price looking inside for Salley. Salley gets the ball inside and scores.
Well, he was lucky to get that inside, too. Vargas really fighting for post position in there, and John Williams backed off. Didn't help at all.
Bernard Woodside, a 6'6 sophomore from Hempstead, New York, and Jose Vargas, both coming in the ball game. This was a key substitution in the Memphis State game for Dale Brown that helped turn the ball game around.
Now Georgia Tech's gone away from their zone defense. They're back man-to-man. It's going to be Salley on Williams.
LSU's lead is one. Taylor goes up. Vargas off the glass. And they're going to call the Georgia Tech foul. It'll be on Salley, his third. Let's take a look at the shooting score. We talked about it at halftime, Larry. Georgia Tech, 50%. But look at LSU dropping here.
And I think it gets back to 2 points. One is the fact they came up with a lot of loose balls and the fact that their offensive rebounding has improved. LSU really turning the numbers, even though they're not shooting well.
And they're not getting the offensive rebounding as much now, but they're still in front by one. They led by six at the half. Looking for Vargas, who's posting up Hammond. Williams gets the ball. He's been a non-factor. Anthony Wilson gets tipped away by Vargas into the hands of the Tigers.
And another loose ball for the Fighting Tigers.
Wilson. Williams gets the rebound to keep it alive. And another offensive rebound for LSU. That's the way they played in the first half.
But the two things we've talked about, the fact they're coming up with the loose balls and the offensive rebounds, have really spelled the difference for LSU.
9:34 remaining in the second half in a one-point game. LSU, the underdog, leading Georgia Tech by one. And Dalrymple got his hands on the ball and made a sensational play. Taken back by Anthony Wilson.
And another loose ball taken by LSU.
It looked like Tech was going up ahead to a two-on-one for a while. John Williams in the corner. Plenty of time on the shot clock.
I think you get the feeling watching LSU right now. Everything seems to be going their way, and everything going against Tech.
Yeah, Tech is not that far off in this game. Wilson misses. Salley the rebound. Georgia Tech looking for the lead again. Price finds Dalrymple baseline. Nearly turned it over. Price hits. Texas in front again. 48-47, our ninth lead change of this game.
Point to make. Don Redden has disappeared. He has not played a lot for LSU in the last 4 to 5 minutes. He's not been scoring like he did in that first half in the early part of the second.
Georgia Tech with a monstrous lead. 13-8, considering how close this is off the glass. But Taylor comes back. Derek Taylor with 14 points. Redden with 18 points. He's had that number for quite a while now. And LSU again with the lead.
We're back to those crossed arms now. We're going to have somebody chasing. That means one person chasing man-to-man, the other four in a zone.
Dalrymple hitting. He's been off the mark shooting outside, and there is Bobby Kremins with his defensive signal.
We're going to need flashcards here in a minute.
11 lead changes in this game. Georgia Tech in front right now with just under 8 minutes to go in the second half. Redden is fouled. He really has been effective in drawing the fouls today. Bobby Kremins doesn't agree with it, and that's four on Dalrymple. He'd be a tough man for Kremins to lose.
Well, he's got 7:46 left to play. Now the decision is his. Do you pull him out, sit him on the bench for 3 or 4 minutes, or do you leave him in there?
He's going to go with Craig Neal, the sophomore from Washington, Indiana, who has performed so well off the bench, coming off the bench as a guard all year for Tech. Redden shooting two. LSU knocking off Purdue in two overtimes. And Memphis State, the third seeded team, on a shot, the buzzer by Anthony Wilson, trying to win their third upset. Georgia Tech beat Marist and then Villanova. Somewhat of a struggle for Georgia Tech. Alertly stays on, and they're going to call it a held ball, and the possession is points to LSU.
But Dick, it was another loose ball that LSU right. was able to come up with.
So alert. Quickness. John Williams. Rebound, Salley. I wonder whether John Williams' hand is bothering. His left hand suffered tendonitis after a intravenous shot in his hand instead of his arm, and it bothered him, had no feeling in it before the last game. Mark Price comes back, however. Georgia Tech is leading 52-50 with 7:19 to go.
Well, this is the one thing Dale Brown feared. He didn't want Mark Price to get hot, because when he does, he can shoot you right out of a game.
Down by two, Redden, been the man of the hour for LSU, ties it up. Game has been tied 10 times, and we've had 11 lead changes.
Did I talk about him disappearing? All of a sudden, he's back on stage.
North Carolina coming back a bit, still trailing Louisville by 8 points. 6:49, Larry.
LSU 2-3 zone right now. Georgia Tech trying to recognize that zone and set up the appropriate offense.
Neal and Price, long range.
That's the appropriate offense.
18 points for Mark Price. He's had 12 here in the second half, and Georgia Tech the lead once more.
Dick, good ball game. Good ball game.
As we anticipated. Steal by Neal. Greg Neal gives Georgia Tech a 4-point lead, matching their 4-0 lead early. Timeout.
Watch it again. Craig Neal sneaking around from behind. LSU did this in the first half. Tech giving them a little bit of their own medicine. Great defensive play by Georgia Tech and Craig Neal. Kremins' reaction.
His team was down by 6.5. They're up by 4 now.
Mercedes-Benz was building sports sedans before there was such a term as sports sedan. Experience pays. The Mercedes-Benz 190 class. The heart of a sports sedan. The soul of a Mercedes-Benz. The 190 class. Something more than a sports sedan. Nothing less than a Mercedes-Benz.
Across the sea, in your land, flew a gleaming carriage called United. Wherever it flew, the skies were friendly, but it did not fly to our land. Then one day, a new wind blew the friendly skies from all 50 states to Tokyo, Osaka, Sydney, Hong Kong, many lands here. United Royal Pacific Service, truly a fresh breeze across the Pacific.
You're not just flying, you're flying the friendly skies.
Georgia Tech has turned the game around on a 10-point turnaround, down by 6, leading by 4. But keep in mind, LSU has done it with John Williams, who really has been marked absent from this game. He has missed his last 9 shots and 2 of 15 from the field.
And Dick, they're only down by 4 points with their best player playing like that.
Winding down to 6 minutes to go. Rice is harassing Taylor.
Neal had thoughts about going after another steal.
Taylor off the glass and in. Cuddy shots from the backcourt. Wilson with 8, but Taylor with 16 points. Second to Redden's 21 for LSU. Tech has hit its last 5 shots. Neal calling the play out to Farrell.
Looks like LSU might be in a little bit of a different defense now. Oliver Brown is way out here on Price. I think they're trying to decide whether it's a zone or a man-to-man. Nobody went with Neal. That part's zone. Oliver Brown right on Price, though. He's honking him.
Farrell, Price gets a low pass. Oliver Brown and Taylor trying to slough off to him. 9 on the clock into Hammond. Knocked away by Derek Taylor. Fine play by the playmaking guard. Oliver Brown, not an offensive force, but Taylor has been, and he has 18 points in the game.
Well, look who's coming to the top. Derek Taylor. 2 big baskets to get the game tied.
5 minutes to go, and we're in a tie. That's 11 in this ball game. Georgia Tech has still hit its last 5 shots, but LSU hawking the ball. And it's still Tech ball as Taylor and Price bumping things over there, the 2 guards.
Having a friendly little matchup over there.
Here's John Williams, who has missed 9 in a row, coming back in the game, replacing Oliver Brown. And if John Williams can ever get cooking, Dalrymple back with 4 fouls, LSU could be sitting pretty, but right now, he's been nullified.
You know, Dick, with less than 5 minutes to play, you got to look for Taylor. He's the guy that really led Heaton Redden.
North Carolina's come back now, trailing Louisville by only 2, 71-69 in Houston in the Western Regional Semifinal. Farrell.
Good ball movement by Georgia Tech, but they're not getting anything out of it.
12 on the shot clock. Inside of Hammond. He's hit a few like that tonight.
Well, they found the ball inside against that LSU zone defense right in the middle, and Hammond has been able to convert.
He's hit his last 4 and has 14 points. Georgia Tech leading by 2 again.
Georgia Tech back in their zone defense. They've gone away from their man-to-man. They're going to make LSU earn it from the outside.
Taylor, how much can they go to the well? I guess until he misses. Taylor now with 20 points in the ballgame.
The bucket still keeps up full.
You've got to credit Redden with 21 and Taylor with 20, picking up the slack where John Williams has not been effective tonight for LSU. Tied at 58. Steal again. Taylor, 3-on-3, finds John Williams. He may be reluctant to do anything now, the game he's had.
Yeah, he may feel the pressure right now and does not want to come forward. He's going to let Taylor do it. Well, has Taylor ever done it in the second half?
Redden in the first half, Taylor in the second half for LSU. Here's Redden. And LSU has the lead again, 60-58.
I think it's just incredible shooting. They are really shooting the ball well from outside.
LSU's defense have forced those turnovers and a timeout call. With 3 minutes and 22 seconds to go, what better cheerleader to have and an optimist than Dale Brown on the sideline?
One could ever deny you're on your way to the top, and along the way you've always known just who you are.
Where you're going, you've always known it.
No other beer is brewed and aged like exceptionally smooth Michelob.
Where you're going is Michelob.
Here at Hewlett-Packard, we believe that the best way to solve your business computing problem is to make it our problem. Because we know that whatever system we design for your company, we're going to live with it too. We never stop asking, what if?
Wait a minute. They have this incredible backlog of data requests.
You're right. What if we use the 3000?
The Omni in Atlanta, Georgia, in a tremendous game here in the Southeast Regional Semifinal. Dick Stockton and Larry Conley, back and forth they've gone. 12 ties, 12 lead changes. The timeout story and the time remaining is 60-58 LSU, and Bobby Kremen has quieted down John Williams, the star of LSU, but Don Redden and Derek Taylor have combined for 43 of LSU's 60 points, Larry.
Right now, when you take a look at these two clubs and you think that Georgia Tech's been able to do that to Williams, look at this guy right here, Don Redden. He has carried the offensive load. He and Derek Taylor will file a 320.
Georgia Tech is shooting 58% from the field, and North Carolina, down by 12 at one point, tied it up in the Western Regional Semifinal in Houston. 3:08 on the clock. Every possession critical. Terrell almost tied up. Salley loses it out of bounds to LSU.
Tech is playing nervous. They're playing very, very nervous.
And they have played this way. I don't know about the Marist game, when Marist really challenged them more than Bobby Kremen's would have liked. But certainly against Villanova, Georgia Tech had a chance to blow out Villanova, leading by 18, and they allowed Villanova to get back in the game.
Boy, LSU now with an opportunity for a four-point lead. Good defensive play by Farrell there. Not able to come up with it. LSU with a four-point lead could put a lot of pressure on Georgia Tech right now.
Greg Neal comes back in the ballgame, and they're going to bring Hammonds out. Georgia Tech has committed 15 turnovers in this game. LSU only 4. That's a very big factor in this contest. And that's what has been the result in points.
Turnovers have been the key to this basketball game.
John Williams. To Redden. Again outside. Redden again hits.
Don Redden. Two fists up in the air. He's going to go to the 2-3 zone now.
Redden has hit his last four shots. 2:25 to go. 62-58. LSU by 4.
Price is open.
Price. He hits. What marksmanship we're seeing from Price, Taylor, and Redden in this game. And it's down to 2 again. 62-60. LSU and winding down to the 2-minute mark.
Great shooting. Great basketball game.
Price has 20 points to lead Georgia Tech, and they're tied, Louisville and North Carolina, in the game in Houston.
Terrell is going to have to get on Redden. He's going to have to shut him down, and Price on Taylor.
John Williams has not even looked at the basket in his hand.
Price thought about a steal right here. He's going to make the move if Taylor came up with it.
Taylor, and the rebound, Redden slapped away, diving for the loop ball. Redden keeps it in the hands of LSU.
Great play by Don Redden on the floor, kept his dribble alive.
And Dale Brown wants a timeout. They've got one left with 1:36 to go. They went for the loose ball and they got it again. What else is new?
Today, millions of Americans are better off than ever before. Better off with expertise on how to manage cash, finance mortgages, and accumulate assets. Better off with the finest insurance protection for their lives, property, and businesses. They're better off under the umbrella of one of America's largest diversified financial enterprises, the Travelers. Have you looked under the Travelers umbrella lately?
In Alamance County, North Carolina, Honda lawnmowers are assembled from the wheels up. Beginning with the Honda overhead valve engine, each precision part is fitted and assembled to exacting tolerances. Then, the final critical step that determines whether a machine will meet the Honda standard, the Clara Johnson test. If Clara pulls and it starts, it's a Honda.
Ship it!
The Honda lawnmower. It's easy to start, or else.
LSU leading by 2, and if Georgia Tech gets into a situation where they have to foul, here are the guys on LSU and what they do from the line inside 5 minutes. You don't want to touch these guys.
Forget it. Don't even get close. They may not have a choice though, Dick. They may have to go after somebody. You got to look at the guys who are in the lineup right now.
know, sometimes you don't have a choice. Timeout story. Amazingly enough, Georgia Tech has outshot Dale Brown's team and has hit its last seven shots, including four in a row by Price. But LSU has the lead and the ball with 1:36 remaining. Williams. Burrell looked for the steal. Couldn't do it. Dale Brown calling the timeout. Let's see how he plays it.
Big possession right here.
And the foul is on Burrell. Somebody would have told you, Larry, that LSU would get nothing out of John Williams and yet would be leading the game with less than 2 minutes to play. What would you say?
Never would have believed it. No way.
Their great star, averaging over 18 a game and 8.5 rebounds, has been a silent gun tonight. Coming in the game, Oliver Brown.
Dick, let's carry that even further, though. Let's talk about this LSU team. I think it's a club that is very, very deep. We maybe have not emphasized enough the talents of the other players on this club. We talked a lot about John Williams. Everybody has. This is a good basketball team, LSU.
Redden hits the front end. And, of course, with so much hype, this team is great. This team may not be great. We saw what Arkansas Little Rock has done. Cleveland State still alive in the tournament. I think in the way basketball is now, you can see a team like LSU finish fifth in the conference and all of a sudden turn it on in the tournament.
You got to look at Dale Brown. He got a whole new team in January. He had to readjust everything. Look what he's done in a period of about 2 months.
You pointed out the great defensive play, the changing defenses saved him. Four-point lead for LSU. See if Tech can weather the storm here. Playing in Atlanta in the Omni with a 4-2 this year. Running down to a minute to go. Inside Dalrymple. And Dalrymple may be called for his fifth foul, and he's out of the game. Tough break for Georgia Tech, and Dalrymple has fouled out, having scored 6 points and garnered 3 rebounds.
Watch it again. Do you know who drew the charge? Look at Blanton right there in the middle of it.
Blanton and Redden have been heady players, to say the least, for LSU. And Dalrymple is out, and they're going to bring in Craig Neal. There's Neal. Keep in mind that LSU has 2 fouls to give with 1:05 remaining.
Right now, Georgia Tech, the club, is going to have to be worried about the fouls and who it is they're going to commit it against.
Taylor, and they'll use a lot of the clock if they can. With a minute to go, 64-60, LSU leading, looking for their third upset of this NCAA tournament. Williams inside, finds Blanton, and that matches their biggest lead.
And that might do it.
66-60. Salley passes inside Burrell, and it's 4 points. And Georgia Tech calls a timeout, and they'll have one left.
When you're behind, you've got to press, and that's what Georgia Tech was trying to do. But here's a good dish. Who made that pass? John Williams. He got it inside to Blanton, who was wide open underneath the basket.
John Williams has stopped shooting for LSU, but he has not hurt his team because he has been there getting some key boards, passing the ball at the right time. He has been the epitome of team player because he knows that other guys have taken up the slack tonight.
And Dick, oftentimes you got a guy like that who is that quality of player, he's got a big ego, and he wants to continue to press and score and score. And when he's not scoring, he can sometimes shoot you out of a game. John Williams is not doing that. That's a compliment to Dale Brown to take a player of that quality and say, play the other part of the game and play it well, and we'll still win. Fortunately, he's had Taylor and Red to carry the load.
Final at Houston. They're tied in the second half. North Carolina, Louisville. Their winner will play Auburn. And tonight at 11:30, you can see two other Southeast Conference teams battle, Alabama and Kentucky. And if you want to find out who won and don't want to stay up to see the game, turn away, because we're going to flash the score. Turn away. You turned away? Okay, let's put the score up now. Score is up. No, it's up. It's still up. Take it out. Fun being a director for once in my life. And now you can watch the game again. Mike Burks, our producer of the truck, said, don't get used to it. You won't let him. Bobby Kremins, what a burden on him. Villanova game, they had a chance to blow him out. Turnover story. Look at that, 22-2 scoring-wise.
turnovers.
And Dick, obviously, those came from turnovers, so Georgia Tech has really turned it over a lot more times than LSU.
If I said John Williams scored 4 points and Georgia Tech shot 71% in the second half, you say Tech must have killed them. That's not the way it is. And it'll be 1-1 on the line with 31 seconds. Third foul on Price.
And they're going to see the guy shooting 87% at the free throw line. Like I said, sometimes you don't have a choice.
31 seconds to go. Taylor shooting. He's 3-3 from the line. Gutty bunch of LSU Tigers. Dale Brown coached two straight marvelous games. I guess you could say three. Beat Purdue in double overtime. Memphis State won at the buzzer after trailing by 12 in that game. Missed it. 1 out of 2. 67-62. 29 seconds to go. Georgia Tech needs a lot of points in a hurry. Price. And Williams gets the rebound for LSU. He can dribble. And the ball is last touched by Tech with 16 seconds to go. And Dale Brown's Tigers may be weaving that magic again for three straight.
Well, there's a disappointed young man right there.
And they foul John Williams as John Salley. It'll be 1-1. Led by 12, North Carolina tying it up, and Louisville leads by 6 once again in the second half.
Cardinals are a very talented basketball team, Dick.
And of course, we want to tell our audience that you will see the conclusion of that Western Regional semifinal in Houston. Brent Musburger and Billy Packer with North Carolina and Louisville, and Williams hits the free throw. So LSU in their 8th NCAA appearance, with a record of 24-11, only 5th in the Southeast Conference, have come alive when you want to come alive in the NCAA tournament.
Dale Brown has got to be complimented. Boy, has he done a great job with this club.
68-62, Redden with a steal. Tech gets it back. Price inside to Hammond. 5 seconds to go, and Georgia Tech calls its last timeout. It's 68-64. Bobby Kremen's team not giving up yet.
Puzzled about which airline has the best buy? Numbers are one thing, and Delta saves you up to 75%. A choice of destinations is another, and Delta has over 100. Then there's Delta's fleet of modern, spacious jets, full service with no added charges, and best of all, personalized service from the Delta pros. Once you bring everything together, flying is no longer a puzzle. That is, if you fly Delta. Delta gets you there.
Georgia Tech has used up its last timeout, and LSU leading 68-64. We want to thank the following: executive producer of NCAA Sports, Kevin O'Malley. Michael Burks, fine job, is our producer tonight. Same can be said for Bob Matina and the rest of our crew. Dan Four, our associate producer. Sandy Bell, Roy Hamilton, Sonia Dunn, our broadcast associates. Bob Brown and the rest. Fine job by our technical and production crew. And Marty Aronoff, our statistician, thank you all. So the LSU Tigers, 4 seconds away from scoring their third upset in the NCAA championship. And Dale Brown, who got as far as the Final Four in 1981, only to lose to Indiana in the national semifinals, is about ready to take one step closer again, Larry. Taylor, and the foul. Price fouls him. They didn't use up any time from the clock, but it'll be 1-1 with Taylor, an 88% shooter, going to the line. For Georgia Tech, I guess a lot of people expected so much, and Tech delivered to a point. They'll be 27-7 after this one is over. But I kind of think that everyone around here thought Georgia Tech would get to that Final Four, Larry.
Well, I think when they started, Bobby Kremen's had the obvious ranking at the beginning of the year. There are a number of publications that put them up there as number one. And I think maybe it had been difficult for them to live up to. They looked for a lot of leadership. And the guy that led them most of the year, Mark Price, did not have a great game tonight. He had a good game, but he didn't have a great game. Salley did not have a great game, nor a good game.
20 points for Price, but he missed some key shots when they needed him early. Salley, 11 points. Certainly no terror off the board as Taylor hits the free throw. And when you get to this part of the tournament, if you have a little magic, remember NC State and Pepperdine and UNLV and the rest? And Bobby Kremins is going to bring in John Martinson, the sophomore from Rockaway, as he empties the bench. Willie Reese, the freshman from Atlanta. John Salley, the seniors, go out of the game. Mark Price is out of the game, and they get a hand from the disappointed Georgia Tech fan.
I think that was a nice gesture on Kremins' part to get Salley and Kremins out of there and give them a big hand from this local partisan group.
It's a matter of seconds now for LSU. And Neal's last shot misses, and an unlikely team has advanced to the Southeast Regional Final. Dale Brown's LSU Tigers, 25-11. They were seeded 11th. And Dale Brown has brought his Tigers to another miracle win. Two overtimes over Purdue, a buzzer beater against Memphis State, and a big win against Georgia Tech here at the Omni in Atlanta.
Tremendous win right now for Dale Brown. And disappointed Bobby Kremins going back to the dressing room. He'll have to get ready for next year because the Fighting Tigers